Okay, thank you so much, Cleopatra. So, hi guys, welcome to my presentation, Get Inspired, Data Literacy Journey. And it's a fantastic journey if you can go on that journey and if you know what to do on that journey. So, during my presentation, I will guide you through some examples, how you can start it, and actually data literacy is. So my name is Angelika Glitas. I'm actually half Greek, half Dutch. I speak a little Greek, not that good. I'm married, have three children. I'm a scuba diver master instructor. And I think I work already in the field of data and analytics for around 30 years. Even when business intelligence or analytics was not the common word that we used, more like management information and all this kind of things. I'm a teacher at the University of Applied Sciences in Amsterdam, already for about 13 years. I do that beside my job, because I love to teach. I love to share my experience from the work field. I'm a Click Luminary for 4 years in a row now. I used to work about 25 years at UWV, which is a governmental organization. And my last 8 years there were as a manager of intelligence of a competence center. And now I'm working for Two Focus, a company based in the Netherlands. And we, of course, do projects in BI and analytics, but also we have an educational part of this firm, and there I am the manager of, and we sell trainings, data literacy, and also all kinds of technical trainings. So, data in our daily lives, I think we are not aware of it. Never. We have all these apps on our phones, all these apps that we use around our wrists, smartwatch, Fitbit, Netflix. Everybody knows exactly what we are doing, and we are not aware of that. And based on our usage, Netflix tells us, oh, maybe you are interested in this movie or in this movie. Or Amazon says, okay, you bought this article. Maybe you are also interested in this article. They have all kinds of algorithms behind it. Also in our daily life at work, we have data that we use. We have, of course, fantastic Excel sheets, color-based. We have Scrum boards. We have drawing boards. We have visual performance management. And sometimes even we have beautiful dashboards, for example, in Excel, in a ClickSense. And we use data everywhere around the world, and we are not aware how much we use it. But sometimes we get fooled. We really get fooled. And then Pinocchio comes in. A lie may take care of the present, but it has no future. Indeed. Let me get you through some examples. Mr. Trump, on the 5th of June this year, he sent this tweet into the world. I love to search for all kinds of things on Twitter or LinkedIn to help that, to help educate. And Mr. Trump posted a message with the job gains in history in May 2020. And we are number one. But in fact, what he did here was something really bad. He forgot to mention the month before, when in America, more than 22 million people lost their jobs. So my friend John Swabish, he fixed the graph for the president. And it's a complete misrepresentation of the facts. He didn't show the facts very clearly. And these things, if you are data literate, you understand those things immediately. Another example. This graph is fantastic. And what looks like a huge increase in sales or in selling product, another example, it's dramatically, it's going up from year one to year five. But there is an annoying sound. I don't know. Which sound? I think the windows is open because it's a little bit hot here in the room. Well, I'll try to finish up then. So in this graph, it's very interesting to see that something is growing, and we don't know actually what. And something is missing in this graph, and sadly we can't have a live Q&A now, but the y-axis in this case is missing. And the y-axis is a very important one, because we can see how we measure things and what the value is, for example, in a graph. So if we look in the second step, and we will add, when we add the y-axis in the graph, then you can see that things, what they look like. Because you can see that it starts the y-axis at 5.3 and it ends at 5.9. So actually, the huge increase in sales, it's also a kind of window dressing. And if you were able to read this up front, then you would understand immediately this is not correct. And then if you go to the next step and you start, and you start with a zero, because that's the mandatory if you use bar charts, it should always start at zero, and then you will get a completely different picture. And then you can see it's not significant at all what you are selling, your product, your sales, or whatever. By window dressing, we are misleaded with data, or insight actually created from data. And that's a weird thing. And if you are data literate, you will recognize those examples immediately. So you need the values of data literacy. So what is data literacy then? If you look at the three circles, then you can see that a data literate person knows how to analyze data. He can give clarity around data, explains data, he can design beautiful dashboards, he actually can tell a story around data, or an insight created from data. They can narrate, they can analyze, they can interpret it correctly. And data literacy is the ability to read and to work with and to analyze and also argue with data. I had one project where I was working on in my spare time, and this project was the COVID-19 pandemic. We created a beautiful dashboard with John Hopkins with all kinds of data. We had really a blast in building it, and of course the coronavirus itself. But and then suddenly we were looking at the numbers, we're reading the stories of the world, and it was actually I got upset, because the numbers that you are showing in those dashboards are not correct. And you have to argue with yourself sometimes with data. You have to be critical. You have to be curious. You have to be creative sometimes. But to argue with data and to be critical in your own work as well, in what you are presenting, it made me decide not to show my COVID-19 dashboard to anyone, except the other things around it, like the number of flights that were increasing or downcreasing, or the stock data that we also have inside that big dashboard. So you have to be critical in the things that you show, but you also have to be creative, and you have to be curious to go and search for that story around data. So my all-time favorite project was a project called Call to Balloon. And it has nothing to do with the normal balloons that you put air in that goes up. No, in this case, balloon means that there is a vein, or there are some veins closed around the heart area of a patient. And when somebody gets with his heart, they have this pressure on the burst, 112 or dispatch is called to alarm an ambulance and get them inside to stabilize the patient, make an ECG, and when necessary, a patient will be transported to the hospital into the cut room where the surgery is performed. A stent is brought in into the closed veins and blow up. This is actually the whole process of call to balloon. It's from the moment that it occurs, the dispatch call, the ambulance data, the hospital data, and from there we created a dashboard. A dashboard which was not more than a process. A process, and of course, behind it, there are all kinds of graphs and tables to analyze the data. But simplicity in this case was key. Simplicity of just visualizing a process. And you can see the call to balloon are 1 hour, 90 minutes, and 30 seconds. There is one mandatory KPI here in the Netherlands, which is called a call to balloon, and it needs to be in 1 hour, 20 minutes. Everything needs to be done. the treatment has to be performed within that time slot. So speed is of essence, not only from healthcare perspective. I think that's the main issue. The quicker you help a patient, the better he will recover, and you can actually save lives with speed in this case. So you can see here that the call is in with a dispatch. The ambulance is going out. They drive to the patient. The treatment time, the ECG is made, and the transport time back to the hospital. The delivering the patient to the first aid department or the cath room, and the treatment is performed. And actually, if you look at those simple steps and you analyze those cases that were too late, they were not based on the target, just passing the hospital, the ambulance, and dispatch together with each other and discussing the outcomes and make improvements, that was a big benefit. And they changed a piece at the dispatch. So now if you call in this region to dispatch, alarm that there is a heart attack going on, the people that are reporting the call are being called back from the ambulance. That's one big improvement. The other improvement is that they are not delivered anymore in the hospital to the first aid department, but immediately they will be brought to the cath room for the treatment. And what they saw in the last step was that the room was not ready, so the surgery room was not ready for the next patient. And now the room is always ready for the next patient, so a patient does not have to wait. So fantastic improvements, and they saved about 20 minutes in time in this process, in this particular process. Life-saving and quality of life-improving minutes. But these are some other things. So there was always room to improve. Like what I found out in the data was that the symptoms occurred more than 6 hours before the ambulance was called. So they made all kinds of, with a funny name, you can call it marketing activities, but they were sending out posters, hanging them up in the hospitals, make advertisements on TV explaining what are heart failures, what to do, how quickly can you help, and from there they hope to improve that calls will be made earlier, so the damage is more or less. So fantastic project to work on, and they are still improving, also forecasting and all statistical improvements. It's really a fantastic project. Most fantastic part is that they won a public award and a professional award. They became in 2014 the smartest organization in the Netherlands. They are 100% focused on continuous improvements, and they are communicating with each other, because within the data and analytics area, it's so important that communication is the basis of everything. And what you see in this company is that the data literacy skills is very high, and that we saved any more projects as well, because we also did a stroke project, call to needle, when time is of an essence and a patient needs to get a certain kind of medication to loosen the clot in the blood. And we saved also their 21-minute process. So fantastic, fantastic things that is happening due to the fact that they look at data, they discuss data, they argue with data, they dare to decide based on data insights, and they really improve. And the process is everywhere. So if you visualize your processes, if you agree upon KPIs, then you can make the most fantastic dashboards ever. And the journey actually is the reward. And it begins with simple things like, okay, make a framework. How are we going to work with data? How are we going to help our business users? Every project needs to start from the business, not from an IT department, from the business. And from there, you will grow into a foundation. The foundation, architectural, maybe organizational, and your data strategy is determined, because a data strategy is important. Your data vision is important. If you want everything, and you will ever put everything in a data lake, it's possible, but your focus will be gone. So you have to focus on your organizational goals. The third step is that you are learning and developing and create that analytical mindset within an organization or in schools or whatever. And from there, it all starts simple. One of my phrases is simplicity is key, really. And it starts with the five basic visualizations that there are. That's bar charts, that's a pie chart, a line chart, a bar chart, and sometimes even text objects. And from that, they grow into more advanced visualizations. And you can use also the beautiful FISLIP extension, of course, because I love them. You can add so much value in visualizations. That's fantastic. And from there, curiosity arises within an organization, and some hypothetical questions are asked. I had one question from a healthcare department, a healthcare hospital here, a first aid. How many people will be on our visiting next year? How much will it grow to see if our budget is request is okay? Or if it's snowing, we have more patients than ever on the first aid department. And actually, we found out it's not true. It's just that the diagnose code is different, not the number of patients. It's different illnesses where people come to the first aid department. And from there, you can grow to more analytics, more advanced analysis, more even prescriptive, like ordering already a machine part from a supplier to repair your machine based on sensor data. You can do a lot of things. The journey is endless. But it's so fantastic to go on the journey. But you need to have that plan, that framework, and a learning environment. That's the most important thing. So that was my presentation. And let's get on that mountain and become data literate and work on the skill sets. So if you have any questions, I have some room in there. I don't think there are. No, there are no questions. So, guys, if you want to learn something about data literacy, just call me on LinkedIn. Reach out to Stefanos and Cleopatra from Witsite in my beautiful hometown, Athens, and Twitter, connect, ask questions, and I hope to meet you somewhere in person. And let's hope we can survive this this horrifying virus which is spreading in the world. Thank you for your attention, and I will give the room to Cleopatra. Thank you, guys. Bye.